Well,
Idiot's Delight.
He called me Idiot's Delight. He said all the kids was a bunch of idiots. They should all be slapped in the mouth. What I think.
Let me read it to you. I think that's a little bit different. Says, when this day is over, an unhealthy hunk of Miami's teenage girls will have unashamedly screamed their lungs out to frank adoration of the biggest freak in modern show business history. In 7 stage shows at the Olympia yesterday and today, Elvis Presley is a no-talent performer riding the crest of a wave of mass hysteria unprincess. Do you want, how's your feeling on that parenthesized item? No-talent performer.
I don't even want to think about it. He ain't nothing but an idiot. He wouldn't sit up and write all that stuff.
He just hates to admit that he's too old to have any more fun, you know?
He's drawing an average of 2,000 kids a show, and nearly all of them are girls. And that, we're continuing now with this quotation. Elvis can't sing, can't play the guitar. Can you play the guitar?
No, and I can't sing either, but somebody likes it.
And can't dance.
No, can't dance.
I
can't do nothing but read Herb Rawls' article in the newspaper. That's all I can do.
Yet 2,000 idiots per show, containing the quotation, yelp every time he opens his mouth, plucks a guitar string, or shakes his pelvis like any striptease babe in town. You shake your pelvis like any striptease babe in town?
Well, he should know. I guess that's where he hangs around.
In over a decade of active professional participation on the fringes of show business, we've never seen anything like it, Rao says. Nor can we understand it. A division of infantry fresh from the front lines never screamed at Bob Hope like Miami's teenagers are screeching for Elvis Presley. Judy Garland killed him at the palace, but they never heard anything like this Olympia wing ding. Nor did Al Jolson at the height of his glory, or Frank Sinatra, or Will Rogers, or Jerry Lewis, or Bing Crosby. New paragraph. If what Elvis Presley dishes out is entertainment, then we give up. We're beyond our teens, but not so anciently. We can't appreciate what might appeal to a youngster. New paragraph. Except in regard to Presley. New paragraph. There is our quote, warm-up, unquote, screen program prior to the proceedings on stage. One of the movie shorts is a rock and roll thing featuring Bill Haley and his coppers. New paragraph. They yell and scream through this, too. And if it weren't for the cops and firemen on hand, they'd dance in the aisles also. The screen warm-up routine is reminiscent in staging of another kind of film prior to another kind of performance in another kind of house. Hold it.
Presley, talk. Sir, those kids that come here and pay their money to see this show come to have a good time. What's his name here? Probably might have had a little fun when he was young. I doubt it. But
Herb Rao,
whatever his name is. I mean, I'm not running Mr. Rao down, but I just don't see that he should call those people idiots, because they're somebody's kids. They're somebody's decent kids, probably, that was raised in a decent home. And he hadn't got any right to call those kids idiots. If they wanna pay their money and come out and jump around and scream and yell, it's their business. They'll grow up someday and grow out of that. But while they're young, let them have their fun. Don't let some old man that's so old he can't get around sit around and call them a bunch of idiots, because they're just human beings like he is.
Okay. We'll go back to a quotation. They can't like Presley for his voice or his guitar playing, no matter how lousy both may be. They can't adore him for these things because they scream so loud they can't even hear him sing or strum his guitar. Do you strum your guitar?
Well, I beat on it. I have for quite a number of years. So I'm not an expert on it. I'll say this, and I'd like to add it to what I just got through saying about him. As a rule, most of the adults are real nice. They're understanding. I've had them come around to me with the hundreds and say, I don't personally like your kind of music, but my children like it, and so on, and if they like it, well, I hadn't got any kick about it, because when I was young, I liked the Charleston. I liked the Foxtrot. I like this and that. They're adults with a little intelligence. I mean, you know, that they don't run the people in the ground for having a nice time.
Okay, back to the clipping. What remains, unfortunately, are his pelvic gyrations. and that's the core of his whole appeal, quote, sex stimulation. Any answer to that?
Well, I don't roll my, what do you call it, pelvic gyrations.
Uh-huh.
My pelvis has nothing to do with what I do. I just, I get kind of rhythm with the music. I jump around to it because I enjoy what I'm doing. I'm not trying to be vulgar. I'm not trying to set any sex. I'm not trying to look vulgar or nasty. I'm enjoying what I'm doing. I'm trying to make the best of it.
Where did you get the name Elvis the Pelvis?
From somebody just like the character that's writing this article here.
Do you have any idea who?
No, sir. I wish I knew. I don't know. Of course, I don't like to be called Elvis the Pelvis, but I mean it's one of the most childish expressions I've ever heard coming from an adult. Elvis the Pelvis, but if they want to call me that, I mean, there's nothing I can do about it, so I just have to accept it.
Uh-huh.
It's like you got to accept the good with the bad, the bad with the good.
Okay. Back to the quotation. We're no prude, but we might suggest a gift in these our 14,000 mama girls who, as if it were a fetish, are vocally and mentally and genuflecting to Elvis Presley. A solid slap across the mouth. He means... Rao means a slap across the mouth to these girls. Have you any comment to that?
Yeah, but I don't think I should say it, you know.
Okay, okay. This isn't over the air. This is for TV
well,
guy.
TV guy. I don't think I should say it, you know.
Okay.
Because I'm now, a singer, not a fighter.
No, they also ask. I ask, where did you pick up your style?
Well, sir, I don't know. I really don't know. I just started out doing what I'm doing now.
Have you ever seen anybody else do it?
No, sir, never have.
Have you got any techniques you've added since you started in show business, or is these all...
No, sir, I've been doing the same thing. You know, I've only been in the business, about a year and a half.
Uh-huh.
And, I'm doing the same thing that I started out doing. I haven't added or taken anything away.
Did your first did your first success occur in records or in personal appearances?
My records started selling very well, and then I...
Your records sold before you made any success as a performer?
Yes, sir.
So do you think that your gyrations merely add to the performance you give, or do you?
Well,
do you think that the movements you make have made you famous, or your style of singing?
I don't know, sir.
You have any idea?
I can't answer that.
Okay. There was I read a clipping somewhere where you were attributed as saying that the hola roller, you would...
I have never used that expression. Well, that's another deal. See, I belong to an Assembly of God church,
uh-huh.
which is a holiness church.
Uh-huh.
I was raised up in a little Assembly of God church.
Uh-huh.
And some character called them holy rollers.
Oh, I see.
And that's where that got started. I always attended a church where people sang, stood up and sang in the choir and worship God, you know.
Uh-huh.
And I have never used the expression holy roller.
Do you still attend church?
Every opportunity I get. I don't have as much opportunity as I used to because I'm on the road most of the time.
In the Holiness Church, do they have peppy music?
Peppy music?
Mm-hmm.
They sing hymns and spirituals. They sing spiritual songs.
They sing them at fast tempo?
Yes, sir, they do sometimes.
Mm-hmm. How long have you been going to that church?
Ever since I was old enough to walk.
About 5 or 6, huh?
Yes, sir.
And do you think you transfer some of that rhythm into your...
That's
singing?
Not it. That's not it at all. There was some article came out where I got the jumping around from my religion. My religion has nothing to do with what I do now.
Uh-huh.
Because type of stuff I do now is not religious music. My religious background has nothing to do with the way I sing.
Do you recall the first time you sang in public? Do you remember when the first time you...
Yes, sir.
It
was back when I was about 10, 11 year old. I was in an amateur program in a fair.
And did you use a lot of gyrations then?
Well, I wasn't doing the type of songs I'm doing now.
Oh.
Nobody knew what rock and roll was back in those days.
Well, when you hear rock and roll, it gets you on the fire, or?
Oh, not when I just hear it on the radio. When I'm doing it on the stage, you have to put on a show for people.
Yeah.
In other words, people can buy your records and hear you sing, and they don't have to come out to hear you sing. You have to put on a show in order to draw a crowd.
Yeah.
If I just stood out there and sang and never moved a muscle, the people would say, well, my goodness, I can stay home and listen to his records.
That's right.
But you have to give them a show, something to talk about.
Now, in this show, we've established that it is a show that you put on. Now, how did you get the idea for the rapid amount of action? Have you ever seen anybody move around as much?
No, sir, I never have.
Had any old showman advise you ought to do it?
Nobody has ever told me.
Uh-huh. Where is the first time that you used the rapid action?
My very first appearance, after I started recording, I was on a show in Memphis where I started doing that, and I was on a show as an extra added single, a big jamboree in an outdoor theater, outdoor auditorium, and I came out on stage, and I was scared stiff.
Mm-hmm.
It was my first big appearance in front of an audience. And I came out and I was doing a fast type tune, one of my first records. And everybody was hollering, and I didn't know what they were hollering at. Everybody was screaming and everything. And then I came on stage and my manager told me that they was hollering because I was wiggling my legs.
Mm-hmm.
And I was unaware of
who was your manager? That
Bob Neal.
Bob Neal, okay.
And so I went back out for an encore, and I did a little more. And the more I did, the wilder they went.
Three a day.
On the vitamins? I was thinking, I thought you were about a 3-day show.
Yeah.
Okay. Now we're down to the question. In other words, you picked up your style when they appreciate just a little wiggle. You figured they'd appreciate more with a little more wiggle, and they did. So now you really give them the works, right?
That's right.
Okay.
I'll say this, sir, before we go any further. It's back on the subject we were talking about at first. Talking about reporters, there's a rumor has gotten out that I don't have no time for reporters, that I just answer with a yes or a no. And it's very untrue. I have my first one yet to turn down. I've never turned down a reporter. I've never turned down a disc jockey. I know that I can't visit radio stations like I'd like to, but I don't have time. And I have never turned down a reporter. I have never been sassy to one. In fact, I've never been sassy to anyone. And I've always stayed and talked to them as long as they wanted to talk. And
why I
admire them. Well, because they keep us in business. I mean, the newspaper columns, the reporters, the disc jockeys, we all work hand in hand.
Do you recognize, or do you have any idea one way or the other whether the criticism has helped or hurt your career?
I don't know, sir. I wish I knew.
Would you agree with myself in the opinion that the criticism has helped skyrocket you with a defense coming to your rescue every time somebody knocked you? Every knock was a boost, in other words?
Well, that makes a lot of sense.
Here's a new question now. What is your reaction to the NBC comment after they learned Sullivan had hired you that you are just a flash in the pan?
Maybe they're right.
I don't
know. Nobody knows. In fact, if I knew, I would be a mastermind. I'm not.
Okay, that's a good answer. Next question is, what about your acting career? Do you have any plans for an acting career?
Yes, sir, I do.
You have a contract now with?
I have one with Paramount.
And how long is it?
7 years.
7 years, and how many pictures?
Picture a year.
Can you give me an approximation of the amount of that contract over the 7 years for the amount of fee that you'll receive?
No, sir, that's never been released.
Have you ever had any experience in acting before?
I've never read a line in my life.
How do you figure on going about learning to become an actor?
Sir, I don't think you learned to become an actor. I think you just, maybe you've got a little bit of acting talent. You develop it. I don't think you learned to be an actor. If you learn to be an actor, in other words, if you, you're not a real actor.
In your acting, are you taking advice from anyone?
I take advice from anybody.
Well, I mean, is anyone responsible for assisting you in that?
The Colonel is responsible for assisting me in everything.
I've
talked to veteran actors. I've talked to a lot of the producers and directors in Hollywood, and they always give me advice. Well, I wouldn't say that, but they told me that I had good possibilities because when I took my screen test, like I said, I had never read a line. I had never studied acting or been in any plays or anything. I got out there. I knew my script. They sent it to me before I came to Hollywood.
And I got out there. How long the script was it? How many pages or lines, you know?
It was about 15 pages, I guess.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
And I knew my script, and I got out there and just tried to put myself in the place of the character I was playing. And I just tried to act as natural as I could.
Uh-huh. And did you have any wheels that approved the test that you know? You know,
you mean
any of the movie wheels?
Well, all of them saw it.
Uh-huh. do you look forward to your acting career?
Yes, I do. I think I'm going to enjoy it.
Do you think that will eventually become your main source of income?
I don't know.
Wait and see. Are you looking for... That is the next question. Are you looking for a TV show of your own?
No, I'm not. I've never thought about it.
If not, why not?
I'm just not ready for that yet.
You mean in the experience, in your own experience, you're not ready yet?
That's right.
Next question. Who are your most avid fans? What age group would you say?
Well, I don't know. Most of the teenagers, I guess.
Have you had many older people grow real excited when you're around, if you recall?
Well, not when I'm around. I've
tried to get to you.
I've seen quite a few adults,
men or women,
mostly women, jump up and down and scream.
Do you recall seeing any gray-haired women jump up and down?
Well, there was one in Tampa, Florida, yesterday.
That was August the 5th.
August the 5th, yeah. One lady.
About
65-year-old or 70. She was completely gray-haired. She was clapping her hands and everything. Just right along with the other people.
But most of them are teenage girls. How about the boys?
Well, the boys, they seem to like the music.
Who is this boy that just came up with me?
You the one that came with me?
What's your name?
Jerry Gamble.
Jerry?
Gamble.
How do you spell it?
G-A-M-B-R-E-L-L.
G-A-M-B-R-E-L-L. Let me get that name again. Jerry, J-E-R-R-Y.
Yes.
G-A-M-B-R-E-L-L.
Yes.
And give me your comment that you told me in the car when we were coming up to the show tonight. What, again?
I said I liked Elvis Presley about as good as some girls.
And why?
I just like his style.
And the rhythm, did you say?
Yes, sir.
Uh-huh. Okay, that's an intervention there of you. How old are you, son?
15.
Of a 15-year-old boy who came to see a show tonight. He said he liked his show as well as the girls did, almost, because of the rhythm and the action. Next question. How about tiny children? Do you have any tiny children before we go to the next question?
Quite a few of them. In fact, I guess I get more real tiny ones than I have adults.
How do you handle autographs?
Well, what do you mean, how do I
handle? How do you keep from... do you autograph everyone that reaches you?
Everyone that gets to me, I always do.
Uh-huh.
I've never turned anybody down.
Sometimes you seem to disregard the protection given you by the people in the theaters and the ushers and so forth, and maybe shake hands with someone, reach over the rail or something like that, or you open the window when you're riding in a car when you know it you shouldn't.
Yes.
Why do you do that?
Because I hate to In other words, if it wasn't for getting mobbed and maybe clothes torn off and stuff like that, I would go right out in the middle of those people. But I hate to turn anybody down who wants autographs, buys pictures and wants to get them signed.
How many autographs do you sign a day?
Well, I don't know. But I hate to turn anybody down. But in a situation like, most of the time the crowds are so large so you couldn't autograph everybody.
Have you noticed the girls who scream and shout the most, are many of them blondes? Have you noticed?
No, that doesn't mean anything.
No, I seem like so many of the girls that I've seen are bleached blondes. Do you don't notice?
I haven't seen that many. I saw more in Tampa, Florida on the same date than anywhere else.
Oh, that just seems to be a local situation.
Yeah, that just probably happened. Maybe it's a fad going around Tampa.
I see.
That doesn't mean it. I mean, it's girls, brunettes, redheads, streaky, and everything.
Yeah. Most of the boys, do most of the boys wear long sideburns, or do you notice?
No. But there's a lot of them wear them, but I guess it's more with crew cuts than anything else.
Uh-huh. How did you happen to adopt long sideburns?
I just always wanted to. When I was growing up, I always wanted to grow them because...
Make you feel like a bigger man or older?
Yeah, makes you look a little older, and I just always liked them.
Did you ride motorcycles when you were a kid?
No, sir. I ride one now.
Uh-huh. Generally, you think of a motorcycle rider as being long sideburns, that's why I was asking.
Yes,
how is showtime? We doing all right?
Yeah, we've got a few more
minutes. Next question. Do you have any opinion why you are such a big hit? Now this is a question that a lot of people want to know, so think about it, yeah.
Well, that's a pretty stiff question, sir. I don't know how to answer you. I just, it's all happened so fast, I don't know what it is.
Well, now, when you're performing and the screams, you realize that the every movement will bring a surge of screams from the crowd. Do you enjoy making a movement that will make the crowd scream?
Yes, sir.
And do you sort of play the audience? I mean, see which side of the auditorium you make scream, or do you try to work the audience in any way?
Just try to work the audience. Half the time I can't even see the audience.
Half the time.
And in most theaters and auditoriums, the lights can keep you from seeing anywhere.
Sometimes occasionally I notice you throw your head back and laugh. Is it because you enjoy making a surge of noise come up?
No, I get tickled. I get tickled sometimes, maybe some little girl.
Some individual?
Or a girl, an individual in the front row will do something real funny like grab her hair or something like that.
What's the funniest thing that you recall seeing happen on the front row? That made you laugh. And have you ever gotten broken up on your show by something happening in front of you?
Yes. The whole band has, every time.
Where was the last time?
I don't remember exactly where, but a couple of times I had to walk off stage. I get so tickled or something.
Because of the rough house or because you got tickled?
Because I got tickled.
Can you remember that incident when you had to walk off stage?
I remember what was happening. This girl, this blonde girl in Atlanta, Georgia, had come to three different shows and had sat on the front row and screamed all through all of them. And then the night we closed, well, she decided to come up on the stage. So she made a dive for the stage and had got almost up there, and about five policemen grabbed her, and she was fighting them just like some man would.
Now I'm done.
And everything. And the audience was just broke the audience up.
Uh-huh.
She was screaming, "Let me at him," and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I got so tickled till I had to walk off stage.
Well, did you leave for her protection or just because you were tickled?
Because I was tickled.
Uh-huh. And then did you come back out?
Yes.
And by that time, what had happened to the girl?
They had killed her. I don't know
what happened.
I didn't see her anymore. I must have taken her outside.
It asked another question, which I've already asked you, I think, but I'll ask it again. How do you feel about having to calm down for the Steve Allen show? You say you didn't have to calm down.
No, I didn't have to.
Nobody asked you? Your manager?
Yeah, yes. few people asked me, but I didn't still didn't have to unless I had wanted to. But I didn't want to make anybody mad, so I did.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question or two about Tom Parker. How did, that's the Colonel Tom Parker of Madison, Tennessee, who managed Hank Snow, Eddie Arnold, and some of the others. How did you first meet Tom Parker?
Well, when I was with Bob Neal was my manager. The Colonel used to take shows out on the road. He'd hire me for an extra added single. Mm-hmm. And he undoubtedly liked the performance that we did, so he decided to start working together, him as my manager.
Well, did Bob Neal turn you over to Tom?
Yes, well, his contract was up.
Well, his contract was up?
Yes, I had been with him a year.
And did you pick Parker, or did Parker come for you?
Well, we more or less picked each other. In other words, it was like this. The Colonel, if you want me as your manager, I'll do the best I can. I told him, if you'd like to manage me, I'll work for you. It was a deal like that, you know.
What date did Tom Parker take over?
It was March the 15th.
Of what year? This year?
Yes, sir.
1956.
This
is August.
Yeah,
March. And he's just been with you for 3 months. Well, you had
Wait now. March, April, May, June, July, August. You've been with about 6 months.
6 months. Has that been the period of your biggest rise in popularity?
Yes, definitely.
Do you ascribe any of that rise in popularity to his operation?
Most of it, yes, sir.
Well, then a while ago I asked you a question about, do you have any opinion as to why you are such a big hit? Do you think that the promotion which Parker handled has anything to do with that? You becoming a solid hit, or do you think you would have been a hit anyway? That's kind of a tricky question, but how were you doing?
Well, the Colonel is a very I was doing. I was making quite a bit of money, but I mean, I wasn't as nationally known as I am now.
Because
the Colonel has a lot of friends in the entertainment business. He has a lot of connections.
Oh yeah.
Knows lots of people that are important wheels in the business.
Do you recall any publicity gimmick or promotion gimmick that he used that amused you particularly, that worked out?
He's a very amusing guy. He planned stuff that nobody else would even think of. I could tell you lots of things. I don't have the time right now.
Okay.
Getting
close.
There is
right. Okay, well, I'll thank you.
Why do you see him, man?
Do it easy, no trouble.
I want to move.
Okay.